I'm Pat McDonough, and welcome to Super Citizen, our great conservative pro-business television show that's on prime time every Sunday at 10 a.m. in the morning, and welcome to the show. Start off with some good news today. We're going to start off with the results of a lawsuit in Baltimore County, a lawsuit that was unexpected in terms of the results. The citizens, taxpayers of Baltimore County filed a lawsuit against the animal shelter because they felt the animals were being mistreated and it was inefficient and mismanagement in Baltimore County. Surprisingly, the highest court in the state of Maryland has decided that taxpayers have a right to sue the government for mismanagement or inefficiency, any taxpayer. In other words, you don't have to have an animal in that animal shelter. Any taxpayer can sue the government in Baltimore County and maybe the entire state of Maryland. We're not sure about how the results go. But for example, in Baltimore County, we can sue the Baltimore County Board of Education for mismanagement, inefficiency, and even danger to our children in Baltimore County, where there is bullying and violence out of control, and the county education system isn't doing anything about it. Some more good news is that President Trump has been appointing federal judges at the circuit court and district court level at a rapid record rate. As you know, the U.S. Senate put into gear the nuclear option because the Democrats were holding up so many of Trump's appointments. They needed to do something different. So on a majority vote, they can now appoint these judges. George Bush had 8 judges rejected. President Obama had 5 judges rejected. And President Trump had almost 100 judges and appointees rejected. So this is a big change. This is something else. We all hear about in the national presidential race on the Democrat side that they're all going to unite against President Trump after the election is over for the Democratic nomination because they hate Trump so much. Some of the polls that are coming out indicate that the radical lefties are not going to unite against Trump because they believe that if a fellow lefty gets elected president, their careers are over. They have no chance because for 8 years, that radical leftist will be president and they won't have a chance. So there's pretty good indications that they're not going to unify after the election in the primary to go against Trump. Another good indicator is the so-called golden vote. These are the independents, the moderates, the undecideds. These are the great votes in America that could decide this election. And in all of the polling numbers, they are going up for the president. His polls are getting stronger every week in those key categories. So that's some good news also. And the radical left complains that whenever we try to make voting legal, in other words, legitimate, you have to have a voter's card and some other things, they call that voter suppression. But you know what we just experienced historically in this country? We experienced a coup to overthrow the presidency, and that is the suppression of 63 million voters who elected this president. And as socialism becomes more and more known, the people are beginning to reject it. So that's good news, and that means that in the election of 2020, the American people will have a great opportunity to destroy socialism before it destroys them. That's all good news, and we hope it continues. Kim? That's all good news.
It is good news.
Yes. Now, what do you have on your mind today?
Well, no, I'm glad that we started with good news this time.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah,
and I have to repeat, voter ID is so necessary. We need an ID to get anything these days.
Yes.
But the Democrats feel as though voting, you should just be able to walk in the door and slap down whoever you think is right, which usually ends up being the Democratic
yes.
nominee. And so I think we should really tackle that. And I think we should tackle it as a state, honestly.
Well, voter registration is very important, and it appears to me that they want everybody to vote on election day and then figure out later whether they can vote or not. And we have so many undocumented Democrats in the United States, that it's not fair to the rest of us. So they want to suppress 63 million voters who voted for this president and take away their franchise.
Yeah, but according to them, they're the ones that are being suppressed all the time by their or votes are lost, as we see, we saw that in Florida.
Yes.
If you recall, Brenda Snipes was the one that made it known that if you do not get votes in after a certain amount of time, when they do a recount, those votes are no longer valid. It does expire. So in any way, our voting system is vulnerable, and we should take a good look at it and try to fix it.
Right. Now, what do you have on your mind today?
So I wanted to talk about maybe things that's not so good news. I wanted to talk about basically how they're talking about going into 2020, the black vote. I have to say, as a black woman, that really bothers me. The black vote seems to be just another way to divide us. It's very divisive. To me, as a black person, you could be black in poverty, you could be black middle class, and you can be black and wealthy. I think we should divide people by class rather than divide them by skin color. Someone that is living in poverty may not be concerned about the same issues as a black person living in a middle class neighborhood. So why do they do that? I think it's just a great way to divide. I think they do that also when they talk about the LGBTQ community. To me, we just saw recently that there was a hate, or I guess you can call it a hate crime. There were signs outside of a church in Baltimore County that was vandalized because it said LGBTQ community members are welcome in that church. But that church already has a sign out front that says everyone is welcome. So doesn't the LGBTQ community fall under the same category as everyone? To me, it's very divisive, and I think we should stop this divisive language going forward. And to me, I don't understand why we always have to bring race or either your sexuality into the conversation. That has nothing to do with most of the issues that candidates run on. So why do we do it? I don't know, but I hope it stops.
Well, I think you're right. And I think one of the things that people are very concerned about is that the Russians were allegedly, along probably with the Chinese and everybody else, trying to divide this nation. Mm-hmm. But it looks like the Democrats have already done that.
Yeah.
I'm Pat McDonough, along with Kim Klasek. We'll be right back after this message.
Join the club, the Super Citizen Club. Let your voice be heard across the state. For just $20 a year, you'll receive inside access to our social media network, direct delivery of our Super Citizen newsletter, and advance notice and discounts to our special events and more. Call 410-238-0025. Join the club, the Super Citizen Club, today.
The wall is not the way to border security.
Well, I thought my razor was dull until I heard his speech.
Judge Kavanaugh, you don't belong in this building as a justice.
And that reminds me of a story that's so dirty I'm ashamed to think of it myself. I don't know what they have to say. It makes no difference anyway. Whatever it is, I'm against it.
I'm a no on this nominee.
No matter what it is or who commenced it, I'm against it.
Beto brought a great deal of vitality to Congress.
What the f*** up? I really f***ed up. Fucking amazing.
Beto is a welcome addition to the field.
Your proposition may be good, but let's have one thing understood. Whatever it is, I'm against it. And even when you've changed it or condensed it,
I'm a no on this nominee.
I'm against it.
I've always said for a long time that conservatives and common sense Americans have one big flaw, one big challenge, and that is we don't have the media. So now we have this great television show, but also every Saturday night from 8 until 10 on WCBM 680 AM, we have the Super Citizen Pat McDonough radio show for 2 hours. And it's a great program. It's been on for a long time. So now we have television, radio, and we have direct mail coming up, and we want you to participate. So go to the supercitizenusa.com website and find out all about Super Citizen and what you can do to contribute to unifying the conservative, common sense, constitutional, patriotic vote in this great state. I'm Pat McDonough. Welcome back, everybody, to Super Citizen, and thank you so much for tuning in. This is, of course, our Sunday morning program every Sunday at 10 a.m. And we try to bring to you guests that are involved in our public service as our representatives. And thank you for tuning in. We really appreciate it. Our special guest today is State Delegate Susan McComas. And Susan is interested in talking about something I don't think we think about a lot. But you know, no matter where you are in the state, and this program goes all over the state, 70% of the funding in Baltimore City comes from us, the rest of us, the taxpayers. And Susan, you've been down the legislature a while, so you've watched the dynamics of what's happening and the city's impact on the Maryland General Assembly.
Basically, the city is the 800-pound gorilla in the middle of the room that nobody really says it's Baltimore City. There is a great deal of distrust between the delegates who represent the city versus the rest of the delegates of the state regarding how much they trust the police. I'm on the House Judiciary Committee, so that is just a very big problem that we have.
Now, the Judiciary Committee, it's one of the six big standing committees
of the House.
In the House, and it's right. The one that deals with criminal justice and public safety.
Correct, Baltimore City.
Yeah, or rejecting police protecting Johns Hopkins University.
Oh, that was very bad. We had the bill the year before, and they had to withdraw it. It passed this year, but the problem was that they it passed out of the House and didn't. Basically, it's what we gave them. I think about $30 million. The state itself, not Hopkins.
Kind of like bribery money to make sure it got through.
And then it went to the Senate, and they put on a lot more constraints. And basically, the House agreed to the extra things that they put on the Senate bill just to get the thing passed because Hopkins wanted that bill. And then we find out that the students are chaining themselves to Garland Hall protesting about the bill and wanted the bill to Hopkins to say we don't want it anymore. Hopkins spent a good deal of time dealing with the students as well as the communities. So they spent when the bill was withdrawn the year before in 18, they spent all that time working with the community and the students. The problem with the students is they're young, they're not politically, they're politically politically ideologues, and so I think they're in love with demonstrating.
This is one of the problems we have. There are no consequences for people who want to misbehave or break the law. To give you an example, the students were trespassing, number one. Number two, they disrupted property. They chained the doors and they chained themselves inside. But worse than that, for 8 days, they prohibited disabled people who worked in that building from being able to go to work. That's political correctness on steroids.
Well, the problem is I think that the administration at Hopkins has been maybe too kind and gentle. And
a little bit.
Right, but they have, and they've tried to be as inclusive and as collaborative as possible, but at a certain point when someone's activity harms another person's right to do their
Absolutely.
Business or earn
their
paycheck.
You can throw your fists around, but when your fists touch my nose,
that's,
we have a problem.
That's right. So once again, when somebody's rights collide with another person's rights, there has to be a demilitarized zone and there has to be respect for both sides, took advantage
would
of
you
Hopkins.
Would you say that too many legislators in Annapolis, where you work and you're on that Judiciary Committee, are criminal advocates? When the governor out with a bill, I'll ask you about this. When the governor came out with a bill, I don't know all the details, but it was apparently a pro-public safety bill. And the head of the chairperson of the Democrat Party called him a white nationalist because he wanted to crack down on crime. What kind of mental state is that?
I honestly don't understand the politics of Baltimore City. And in other words, if I would parrot what they, talk about in the legislature in my community, I would be run out on a rail. We are very pro-police in Harford County. We support the police. We support law enforcement. They're very involved in the opiate crisis. They're very involved in keeping the community safe. Down in Baltimore City, they have a real crisis of confidence. The police do not trust the police. Every time we go to a hearing and citizens come in from Baltimore City, we hear about how, look at the Gun Trace Task Force. That Gun Trace Task Force has caused more problems as far as trust in the community for police, and rightly or wrongly, and I think it's a shame. But I think that there's bigger problems in Baltimore City, and I think we need to start looking at one-on-one relations, and the police have to get out of the cars. The police have to go in and meet the merchants. They have to get to know the communities. There's got to be community policing. The other thing is we have some wonderful institutions down in the city. I mean, you have all the churches down there. You have Catholic Charities. You have the beautiful museums, Walters. You have the Baltimore Art Museum. You have all these
People don't want to go.
Well, you have all, but the point is we have a nucleus of bright, bright people with the college institutions, with the medical school, the School of Social Work, that the community, that group could come up with some good solutions.
If we're going to put together a solution summit,
I don't,
a blue ribbon commission,
you can't say they failed or we failed from the very beginning. You have to have respect for they live there. So
you can't have that parochial attitude that you are the only ones who have the solutions. We put 70% of our tax money into that city.
You can't force that on them in that manner.
I say circumvent.
We all got it. Look, it's everybody's problem.
That's why everybody should be involved.
Because Baltimore City can take the whole state down. So we all have investment.
Well, I guess
in Baltimore
maybe we're
City.
Saying the same thing.
Right. I'm saying
we're going to have a solution summit in relationship to Baltimore's economy, small business, education, crime, drugs, we need to have the entire state of Maryland at a Blue Ribbon Commission solution summit with respected people who want to make sure we have solutions. Because if it's a respected group of people, the usual bunch in Baltimore that are the obstacles, they can't discredit that.
But I think you need it on all layers. You need it at the bottom level of neighbor of neighbor to neighbor, parent
oh, yeah,
to
that
parent,
should be part of
student
it. No,
to
no,
student.
I don't disagree.
No, because you can't have the higher ups, the movers and shakers, do something top down. It's got to be top down to help strategize to figure out what the weaknesses and the strengths are. But you need to have it come from the bottom up.
Let me make my point clear, because I think this is an important point. The local leadership in Baltimore City has very different biases, and I'm not talking about race, but they have certain attitudes that prohibit solutions. Okay. Now, yes, you can go from the bottom up. You must involve the community. But you cannot isolate everybody else out and say their potential solutions are something we can't accept. We have to fix it. You can't fix it by yourself. You need the best and the brightest to operate for a whole year, not 3 months, an entire year. And they have to put resources and money into the issue. And they have to come up with a report that makes sense, that's honest, and says, you're not doing this, or you're not doing that.
But that's an audit. What I'm saying is...
No, it's not an audit. It's bigger than an audit.
No,
much bigger.
But what I'm saying, what they need to do is you need to look at each neighborhood, and you need to say, okay, you've got a school, you've got some doctors here, you've got a pharmacy. What does each neighborhood have, and what do they need? In other words, what are the assets that they have right now? So we have a catalog of assets for that neighborhood, and so then you can kind of look at the whole city, and then you'll find out, okay, we have some food deserts. That's one problem. Or we need another sub district for police because there's a high crime rate.
The police are clear across town.
But I don't know if they do that. They have that. I know O'Malley had his city stat, but that was more like the Grand Inquisition when the police officers or the commanders would come in. They were literally chewed up and spit out.
I'm not familiar with that, but a big point that I've been making, and I'm going to stick to it, okay? Baltimore City cannot solve its own problems. It's had 30, 40 years to do that.
No, but we have to be careful.
I don't think we have to be careful.
No, because they have the pride of sovereignty.
I don't know what they have pride in.
No, but I'll give you...
What are they proud of?
Let me give you an example.
No, that's the problem, Susan.
No.
That is
Tony
the problem.
Tony Fulton, who understood Baltimore City, he was a Baltimore City
representative. He was old school and he did, yes.
Right. He wanted to have the state police come in hot spots. Well, you know who came into the House Judiciary Committee to oppose it and said basically, hell no? Gene Hitchcock, a deputy mayor under Mayor O'Malley. They didn't want anybody, any
help.
That's
the problem.
Well, right, but I'm saying you've got to package it in a way so it's not, so that it is palatable and not we're overtaking their sovereignty.
You know what
it's delicate.
You know
it's
what the
a delicate way
not
to do
delicate.
It.
You
no,
know,
it is.
You know what the definition... Well, you're a little too shy about this.
No, it's not shy. It's just I know it works.
Yeah, well, it hasn't worked.
Sugar works better than vinegar.
I don't. Let me tell you what works better. Okay, you know the definition of insanity: making the same mistake over and over again and thinking it's going to have a different result. Baltimore City needs outside opinions. It doesn't need the opinion of the Baltimore Sun. It doesn't need the opinion of the public defenders. It doesn't need the opinion of the state's attorney. It needs the opinion of legitimate people in the city. At the community level, the people at the community level don't trust their leaders in the city. They don't even trust them. They won't even witness. They won't even come out. They have no faith.
Well, it's because they're afraid of the, like what happened to the Dawson family.
Absolutely.
They won't be around.
That's my point.
Well, we got to do something for those folks.
We are both on the same team here. We both want the same results.
Well, we do want the same results. There's no question about that. But I'm very forceful and passionate about this for one reason. The city managing itself has failed, and it needs outside help to take care of the people at the lower levels. It needs an audit like Susan's talking about, what's here and what's there, but there's more to it than that audit. There's about the culture of the city. There's about single member families. There's about kids not going to school and dropping out and nobody's doing anything about it. We need an honest assessment of the real problem in Baltimore City. Gets back to your original point.
Yeah.
And Susan, you're right, and there are some powerful forces in the culture of this state, and particularly in the culture of that city, and we are not going to find a solution or a pathway towards success unless the whole state contributes the best and the brightest to give legitimacy to some of these ideas, because there are people in the city who've lived there their entire life, and they have said things that we are talking about, and it goes nowhere. Because they don't have the power. You need a solution summit that has power behind it to make a difference. That's what I believe. Now, Kim, what everybody's waiting to hear is what you believe.
Thank you for letting me in here. I wanted to talk a little bit about what was going on at Johns Hopkins and how people might have felt about State's Attorney Marilyn Mosby dropping the charges and not even doing any kind of community service or anything, because I believe some of those students weren't actually students. Those were, some of them were trespassers. So did anyone talk about that, as you know?
No, but see, they started that lockdown at Garland Hall after the legislature was over.
Okay.
And so they came and they talked to us, and I mean, I spoke with some of them, and some of them wanted to have a bigger role with the Citizen Advisory Committee that was going to oversee these private police. And
okay.
But the bottom line was is that amendment didn't go anywhere. I made the amendment and there was no second. I mean, because I do think that that's important that they feel part of the process, but the point is that they aren't going to be there forever.
Right.
So, and I think that's one thing that the students need to understand. Mm-hmm. You know, they're there for several years, and Hopkins is a wonderful campus, and
yes.
You certainly, and there's a higher rate of crime in the neighborhood and everything, and it's a wonderful asset, so it should be protected. And if it was a state school, we'd have armed police there, and it wouldn't be a problem. We didn't have to have special legislation.
Susan, I'm so happy you came in. I know you will not return. It was a lot of fun debating with you or discussing with you. That's why we're here, for ideas and opinions. Kim, I'm so sorry you didn't get into the middle, but
no,
I got
fine.
Passionate. And Susan and I used to do this all the time, by the way, in the state legislature. But the great thing about Susan was, for many years, she sat next to me, and she would bring candy to the legislature, and she would hide it in her desk. And when she got up, I would grab the candy bar and hide it. And she would say, "Who took my candy? Did somebody take my candy?" I would sit there like, "I don't know what you're talking about." So since I have left the legislature and Susan McComas, I have lost 30 pounds. So if I got angry with you, I have a good reason. Anyway, thank you. Susan McComas, our great delegate.
Thank you.
And we'll have you back again, believe me, okay?
You sure now?
Yeah, you're entitled to your opinion. Could be totally wrong, but doesn't matter. All right, we're going to take a break. We'll be right back.
Potential Me sells donated items on eBay and uses the proceeds to take those in need shopping for the ideal garment needed for any special or professional occasion. Proms, wedding, family reunions, and graduations in stylish attire. Donations are graciously accepted at potential-me.com or call 443-461-6408. Potential Me.
Who in America doesn't think a president, Democrat or Republican, deserves his or her picks for who should run the agency? I've already said I'll oppose Senator Sessions.
I changed my mind.
Yeah, does it work any better?
Appreciate the opportunity to speak directly to the American people tonight.
Well, I'm caught between two evils. I generally like to take the one I never tried.
I see a man in your life.
And I just want to say to the men of this country, just shut up and step up.
Haven't you ever met a man that can make you happy?
Sure. Lots of times.
You know?
Well, I can always tell a lady when I see one.
Yeah, what do you tell?
Do I bother you if I look over your shoulder?
No, do I bother you?
You know, I've been mad about you from the first time I laid eyes on you. Well, you're my whole world. What do you want to do, drive me to a madhouse?
I rise today, Mr. Speaker, to call for the impeachment.
Oh, I'll call you a taxi.
Kim, you have something very interesting about a restaurant that I had not heard about this. What is this all about?
Okay, so Riley's Oyster is located in Fed Hill, also in Hunt Valley, and the owner also owns Crossbar, which is also in Fed Hill. So this is a guy that's been doing a lot of business in the city. So Brian McComas was called out on Twitter because he said something about the ceasefire movement. And so ceasefire movement, what they do is they call for no shooting over a weekend, right,
good,
in Baltimore
luck.
City.
Yes, good luck.
Right, and so when there was shooting on Friday night, Brian McComas then went on Twitter and said, see, this is what we got. He said, nobody's, and he, I said, I can't quote it for word, but he said, Thug One said to Thug Two, oh, let's not shoot each other, it's ceasefire weekend. And he says, Thug Two says, oh yeah, I forgot about that, let's put our guns away.
Right.
So they immediately jumped on him, they called him a racist, they said what he was doing was racist by saying someone is a thug, which to me, thug has no color
to
it. Right, exactly. But they also started saying that they're going to boycott Riley's Oyster. But I just want to say to the viewers, if you're going to boycott anything in Baltimore City, why not the gas stations or the restaurants and the corner stores that are allowing drug dealers to basically sell drugs on their properties, and those gang members that are actually planning murders and doing other things on their property? Why not boycott those places instead?
Yeah, well, ceasefire is as silly as gun buybacks. Neither one works. If they want to do something, how about boycotting politicians like the Black Caucus and the city delegation that constantly vote in favor of criminals?
Yes.
That would be helpful.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. See us every Sunday at 10 a.m. Conservative, pro-business, super citizen.